Welcome to today's webinar presented by the College Music Society, the fifth in our Musicians Health series for this academic year. I'm Bill Pelto, Executive Director of CMS, and it's my pleasure to MC today's presentation by Dr. Dana Glasenhardt, entitled The Role of the Audiologist in Helping Musicians. Dr. Dana Glasenhardt is a board-certified clinical audiologist who provides diagnostic, technical, and patient-focused audiology services for hospitals and outpatient clinics. She holds a bachelor's degree in music engineering from the University of Miami and the doctor of audiology degree from Nova Southeastern University in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. She received her clinical training at Sensophonics Musicians Clinic and at Resurrection Medical Center, both in Chicago, Illinois. As you'll learn today, Dr. Glasenhardt grew up in a very musical family whose professional music making stretches back many generations. Herself a pianist, she studied European classical technique with the late Dr. Teresa Escandon, pupil of Jorge Bolle at the University of Miami's Frost School of Music. I see that we have over 30 colleagues registered for this webinar from all over the US, Canada, and abroad. Today, I'm broadcasting from Boone, North Carolina, and Dr. Glasenhardt is in Chicago. We are also recording this webinar for later viewing via the College Music Society's online archives. Dana, welcome to this CMS webinar.
All right, well, welcome. This is a presentation of the role of audiology in helping musicians. I'm Dr. Dana Glasenhardt, and it's a pleasure to be here with you. I'll just start off with disclosures. I don't have any disclosures. I work for myself here in Chicago, and if I recommend or mention a product that helps musicians take care of their ears, there's no financial I don't get any financial benefit from it. I'd like to say a special thank you to the College of Music Society, to a colleague of mine, Judy Guarin, my husband, for extra babysitting while I was preparing, and my sister-in-law, who's a fellow scientist in our family and helped me procure some articles that I was looking for. So thank you so much. The College of Music Society asked for me to introduce myself and a little bit about my history. And I am practicing for 14 years clinical audiology in Chicago. Most of my career is with ear, nose, and throat physicians. We call them otolaryngologists. And I've been a part of a medical group, Swedish medical group. And I currently am in private practice. I want to mention some people that are a part of a profound impact on the way I practice, and especially with musicians. So we'll go through the slides here. My dad is a percussionist and pianist. I'll mention Michael Edwards Piano Studio. He's my primary piano teacher when I was in elementary through high school. I went to University of Miami and I studied music engineering. I was also part of Dr. Teresa Escandon's piano studio. I was fortunate enough to be in Michael Santucci's audiology clinic for musicians. And then that brings me to today. Here we go. So with my dad, his name is Linford C. Turpin. He's a percussionist. He was born in St. Andrew's Parish in Jamaica in 1945. He plays a variety of instruments, including piano, organ, guitar, flute, xylophone, vibraphone. And I'm not sure if you can see him here. Let's see if I can get a little pointer, a laser pointer. He is here playing the vibraphone, and he finally gave me a picture of him performing. My dad joined his father in Long Island, New York during his high school years, and that's where he learned to play the xylophone and other percussion instruments. He performed in Carnegie Hall in 1975 as a guest artist, and in our home, you could hear everything from Bach to Harry Belafonte. And it's very enjoyable growing up with him. All right. This is my great-grandmother. Her name is Johanna Isadora Turpin. She is as far back as I can go as a musician in our family. She was born in 1878, which I think is really interesting. Johanna Isadora McDonald. She married and divorced and married again. This handsome young man that is standing next to her. That's my great-grandfather, George Nathaniel Turpin, in 1917. And they had two children, George Turpin, which is my grandfather, he's a junior, and Gilbert Turpin. She was instrumental in my dad's education as well as her son's education for music. My dad grew up with her because his dad enlisted in the US Navy. And so he grew up in their household. His uncle Gilbert was the piano teacher, and his grandmother would often help him with difficult passages, timing, fingering as he needed. She's definitely the exception to the rule, being a woman in that time line of, I just wonder how she became musically literate and you know, what her life was like. So anyway, she makes me a fourth generation musician. Very proud of her. My primary elementary teacher, piano teacher, was Michael Edwards, and I was under his direction from age 5 to 18, and he introduced us into competition. I'm not sure if you can see here, maybe you can. I'll put my pointer. There I am. Excuse the puffy sleeves of the 90s. And here I am in competition. We'll just move on there. I had a heavy math and science curriculum in high school and middle school. And I knew I wanted to do engineering, but I also really wanted to do music as well. And I majored in music engineering at the University of Miami. My principal instrument was piano. I have a double minor in electrical engineering and in mathematics. I was a part of the student recording team that recorded recitals in Gussman Hall and Weeks Hall, many of our other students' junior and senior recitals, as well as faculty, the Festival of Miami. We also recorded, and this allowed me to see professionally what professional musicians go through, setting up, tearing down, doing sound checks, a lot of the behind the scenes portion of it, and recording techniques. So I really can relate to a lot of sound engineers who are looking for like the pristine recording experience. So that lets me relate to it. I also got a chance to record at Hot Springs, Arkansas Music Festival. Beautiful churches throughout the city, and really just some beautiful music we got a chance to record. And I also was an intern at National Public Radio in Washington, D.C. in the summer of 2001. Some great experiences there. So I also got a chance to be in Dr. Teresa Escandone's piano studio as I studied at University of Miami. I was with her for 2.5 years. She's a Cuban-born pianist and a pupil of Jorge Belay. I found an article from the New York Times about her Carnegie Hall performance in 1973. And it wrote that she's known for her technical polish and assured musicianship. And she really was. Pedaling, fingering, how strong your fingers were. And she really introduced the commitment of a professional musician. We knew her practice schedule was at 3 a.m. She would wake up and practice for herself and then take on her students throughout the day. She passed away at the young age of 64 in my junior year. It was a big loss to a lot of us. If you're curious about her, she left and compiled some editions of Jorge Belay's fingering dynamics for a lot of his famous pieces that he performed by Franz Liszt. And it's a testament to him, but also to her. It was definitely her style. of performance. Another wonderful person that I got a chance to meet along the way is Michael Santucci. Once I was a part of audiology, I did my last year, my externship and residency at Sensophonics in Michael's musician clinic. He is known for hearing conservation for more than 35 years. He's a consultant for many, many places, including NASA. And his philosophy is not to change musicians and how they perform and what it is that they want to do. We don't want to get in the way when we talk about making hearing safer or reducing overexposure. He wants you to be able to make music and keep your hearing for your whole life. He's a very calming person when it comes to overexposure, because I feel that he has practical ways to implement it. And very glad to have been a part of it. So just, if I can just say one small thing, if you go into his office, you'll see these patches. And they are the patches that you'll see on astronauts. And they're for all the missions that his products have gone up in space for the space station, as well as different missions. And it's pretty cool. All right. So with all of these impactful people, I became an audiologist. And what is an audiologist? According to the American Academy of Audiology, audiologists are primary health care professionals who evaluate, diagnose, and treat and manage hearing loss and balance disorders, pretty much for all ages. So from infancy, from day one to patients' whole lives. You'll find us in hospitals, ear, nose, and throat doctor's offices, known as otolaryngologists, private practices, school systems, noise hygienists in industry, universities, government, military, and veterans affairs. So how do you find an audiologist? You can find it through your insurance carrier. If you have insurance, your insurance carrier has an in-network audiologist, and typically your physician will order a hearing test as if they're ordering blood work or an x-ray or CT scan. They'll order a hearing test too as well. So you can find an in-work audiologist through your insurance provider. You can also Google us as well. That's always an option. Here is a directory in the United States to find an audiologist. It is www.findanaudiologist.org, and we will try it out here so you can see what it would look like. Very good. And it brings us to the Academy of Audiology website. It's just really easy. If we put in Chicago here, whoops. Not too much private information for myself there. notice that we have specialties. So some audiologists, we have different specialties here. You may be looking for cerumen management, which is wax extraction from people's ears. So you can find an audiologist that specializes in that. Hyperacusis, which is the sensitivity. Here we have hearing conservation. About that. Hearing conservation, if you are looking for earplugs or in-ear monitors, and we have tinnitus or buzzing in the ears too as well. So you'll see that we'll have specialties and certifications too as well. So just wanted to mention, this is what it looks like. Again, it's findanaudiologist.org, and it helps the public find an audiologist in the United States. I did look up if you were overseas to see if there was a another academy. There I am there. Another academy that can help, we do know that there's a British Academy of Audiology. Australia also does have audiology academies. Many countries have audiology academies as well. So if you are overseas or you're traveling or you're touring, you can find an audiologist. We're pretty much everywhere. All right, so ways that we can help. I picked four ways that we can help. One is with a healthy hearing program or hearing conservation, helping you implement that into your life. Cerumen removal, a safe way to remove wax to protect the structures that are behind the wax. That is our goal. So audiologists can help with that. Tinnitus, there are things you can do about it. I really want to take away that myth that there's nothing you can do. So we'll talk about the etiology and the management of that. And I also want to mention sudden hearing loss. Ways that just an education of what it is and if it happens, how to get treatment as quickly as possible. That's going to make the outcome as best as possible for musicians. I think that would be really important for you guys. Okay, so how can we help with a healthy hearing program? If you come in and for a hearing test or for ear impressions, which is usually how I meet musicians, they're coming in for in-ear monitors that they found online that they would like to get, or a custom ear plug, and they need ear impressions. And so they find us and come on in and they tell us that we're musicians and our ears go up, our senses go up, and we usher you into a healthy hearing program. And it's basically just more education and tools to help you use protection when you need it. And we're gonna go into how you hear. Here we go. This is by the National Institute on Deafness and Communication Disorders. Let me just make sure I'm sharing my sound here with you.
Have you ever wondered how sounds make their way from the source all the way to your brain? Take a trumpet, for instance. When it's played, it makes sound waves in the air. The outer ear catches the waves, which then travel through a narrow passageway called the ear canal. The sound waves reach the eardrum, which is a membrane roughly half the size of a dime. They make the eardrum vibrate, which in turn vibrates three tiny bones called the malleus, incus, and stapes. These bones amplify or increase the sound vibrations and send them to the cochlea. The cochlea is shaped like a snail and is the size of a garden pea. It is filled with fluid, and the sound vibrations make this fluid ripple, which creates waves. Hair-like structures called stereocilia sit on top of hair cells and are grouped together as hair cell bundles inside the cochlea. The hair cells inside the cochlea ride these waves, and the hair bundles are moved. The hair bundle on top of the hair cell turns these movements into electrical signals. As the hair bundles are moved, ions rush into the top of the hair cells, causing the release of chemicals at the bottom of the hair cells. The chemicals bind to the auditory nerve cells and create an electrical signal, which travels along the auditory nerve to the brain. Different hair cells respond to different frequencies of sound. The hair cells at the base of the cochlea detect higher pitched sounds, such as a piccolo or flute.
So I want to pause here if you can see my pointer here, there are these three rows of hair cells, and then there's another line of hair cells as they make their way up to the apex. In the high frequencies where the flute sounds are, between 8 and 2000 hertz, these outer hair cells, when they get overtired, they lie down, the tops of the stereocilia lie down. And that's usually where we see the first signs of noise-induced hearing loss. It typically happens in the high frequencies, and it happens to these three rows of cells called outer hair cells. And there's a specific test that we will test you with if you come in to see if those hairs are healthy. Typically, we see a decrease on the otoacoustic emission, sometimes prior to seeing it on the actual hearing test. So I just wanted to point out this row of three cells. Let me continue.
The hair cells toward the top of the spiral detect progressively lower pitched sounds, such as a trumpet or trombone. At the very top or apex of the spiral, the hair cells detect the lowest pitched sounds, such as a tuba. The auditory nerve carries the electrical signal to the brain, which interprets the messages as sounds that we recognize and understand.
Let's go ahead and, so sorry. Very good. We'll head back to our presentation here. Okay, so we'll definitely take a look in your ears. We'll do a otoscopy, a case history. We're gonna ask you some more questions about your instrumentation. We'll talk a little bit more about that. We'll take your ear impressions that you need and we'll put them in a box for you to send out to get your earplugs or your in-ear monitors or whatever device that needs that custom ear piece for. We talked about how the anatomy and physiology of your ear works. And when we do the case history, we're gonna ask you specifically about your instrumentation. What is it that you play? And that really depends on how loud it is, close to being where you are. So if I play violin, my instrument is gonna be, could be on the left side or on the right side, depending on how you play it. And that ear is gonna have more exposure than the ear on the opposite side. If I was a drummer, where my hi-hat is and my snare drum on that side, if it's on my left side, I may have more exposure on my left ear than the other side. So instrumentation is really important. We'll probably ask you about your position in your ensembles, so who your neighbor is. So if you guys are in close quarters, like an orchestra pit, you may be a lot closer to other instruments. If you're a singer and you happen to be close to a particular instrument, or if you're in the orchestra and you're surrounded by other instruments, we're gonna wanna know what that setup looks like. Also your practice schedule, it's not also about how loud it is, but for the duration. So if you do have a long practice schedule, you may have to put your earplugs in when you go out at night. If you guys head to a bar or to a place afterwards, drinks with friends, you may have had your dose for the day just with your practice schedule. So we'll ask you more things about your life. We'll ask you if you've experienced any changes in your hearing, tinnitus, hyperacusis, which is a hypersensitivity to sound, dizziness, family history of hearing loss. Are you more prone to having hearing loss because it runs in your family? We may be more aggressive because of that. Family history of tinnitus, that's a new one and very interesting. A study shows that 50% of people with tinnitus have a parent, a biological parent that also has tinnitus. So that's very interesting. We'll want to know about your medications. If it's ototoxic, which means not friendly towards your ears, can change the potassium or sodium balance there. And also comorbidities. Do you have diabetes? Do you have multiple sclerosis or autoimmune disease that we should know about? These things may impact your hearing. That is not what you're doing in your, just your practice schedule. They could just be other things that we need to look out for. You may not be the only reason your hearing is changing. It could be other factors. So there we go. Let's head to the next slide. All right, so how can we help with a healthy hearing program? While we're taking your impressions, we'll probably be downloading something on your phone, which is a free app. It's a sound meter and it allows us to find out how loud it is where you are. So if you're in the practice room or if you're in your studio, It allows us to find out how loud that is. So we're going to watch a video about that. And noisy app, NIOSH app, which I typically recommend, sound meter app, and Noise Hunter app. There's some other free apps too as well. Feel free if you want to take this time to download it on your phone. That would be great. This is for NIOSH, which is the National Institute on Occupational Safety.
Given how important occupational noise exposure is to worker hearing health, safety, and overall quality of life, NIOSH has released its own free NIOSH Sound Level Meter app for iOS devices, which is now available through the App Store. Some of the benefits the NIOSH Sound Level Meter app can provide are raising workers' awareness about noise in their work environment, help workers make informed decisions about potential hazards to their hearing. It can serve as a research tool for the collection of noise exposure data, promote better hearing health and prevention efforts, and it's easy to use. The NIOSH Sound Level Meter app has many important features using the device's built-in microphone, or preferably, an external calibrated microphone. It provides an easy-to-understand readout of the sound level and will report instantaneous sound levels in A, C, or Z-weighted decibels. The app was subjected to and met the same rigorous testing requirements that were established by a NIOSH laboratory study of commercially available sound measurement apps. While the app is not meant to replace a professional sound level meter or noise dosimeter, or to be used for compliance purposes, the app can help industrial hygienists, occupational safety and health specialists, and workers take good, accurate noise measurements and make informed decisions for the adjustment of their exposure or the need to use hearing protection devices. For additional information and detailed guidance on how to use the app, please visit the NIOSH Sound Level Meter app webpage.
We'll head back to our presentation here. Okay, so once you have that app on your phone, will you app like this? I usually recommend NIOSH, which is the National Institute on Occupational Safety and Health. It is more protective than the OSHA, which is the Occupational Safety and Health Administration. However, the OSHA graph here from 90 to 115, it is sometimes easier to remember. It goes up in fives. So let me just explain the graph here. We'll start with the NIOSH one. Anything over 85 decibels is excessive loudness and exposure to your ears. They have found that 85 decibels, we can last for about 8 hours, and that would be the whole dose for the day. So if I have my phone out and I'm in the orchestra and it's averaging about 85 decibels where I'm sitting, I'm pretty much good for 8 hours, and I don't need to put any plugs in my ears. I don't think you'll be there for 8 hours. If it is louder than 85 decibels, let's say I'm a drummer, and I take out my sound level meter on my phone, and it's telling me that it is 101 or 100. I know that I'm only good for about 15 minutes if I'm following the NIOSH standard. If I put my earplugs in and it's 15 decibels of reduction, I'm going to be down 90 to 85. I'll be back at 8 hours. So if I put my earplugs in and I get 15 decibels of reduction from 100, I'll be safe with those earplugs for 8 hours. So you and your audiologist are going to decide when it is at go time. I'll give you one more example. Let's say it is 88 decibels where I am. I'm good for 4 hours without any earplugs, but I plan on going out that evening. I'm going to want to put my earplugs in if I know that it's noisy. It's going to be louder than 85 decibels because I'm pretty much done for the whole day. I spent my 4 hours listening without earplugs in, and now it's time for me to put my earplugs in if I'm going to spend any more time in excessive loudness, noise, or music. So that's that. We'll probably recommend that you get a hearing test done. Again, your physician can refer, give you a referral for a hearing test, and it's covered typically by insurance. But we also have private pay prices as well, and we don't make it too exorbitant because we want you to get serial tests. We would like to be able to make sure that your hearing is not going south. We'll also, once you get your ear plugs in or whatever device that you're ordering, we can do a real ear measurement, which will put a small microphone in your ear, put your plug or the in-ear monitor in, and we'll see how much reduction you have. So those are ways to check to make sure that we're getting that protection. Another way we can help is with safe cerumen removal. Cerumen removal accounts for 12 million visits at the physician office. So you don't feel like you're alone if you need to get wax out of your ears. The screen is a little bit, there we go. Let me just move this to the side, hopefully. What are we trying to protect, which is behind the eardrum? There's not that much space in your ear canal. It's about 2.5 centimeters long from your pinna, the outside of the ear, to your eardrum. In most adults, it can be shorter than 1 inch or 2.5 centimeters. So there's just not a lot of space in there. Your eardrum is made up of 3 layers of skin. We don't recommend someone go in there to take out wax themselves. Incorrect wax removal can lead to hearing loss, perforation of an eardrum, subsequent surgery to fix the problem, and tinnitus. So we strongly encourage you to see an audiologist to remove your wax. We're skilled at removing what we call uncomplicated cerumen. It is a procedure. We'll give you informed consent so you know the risk and the benefits involved. We'll use either instrumentation like a curette to remove the wax or lavage or irrigation. And sometimes we even vacuum out the wax out of people's ears. We'll test your ear afterwards, which is the key for audiologists. We want to ensure that the structures of the middle ear are intact post-cerumen removal. Once we take out the wax, we are the professionals that will test your ear to make sure that you're leaving with the hearing that you came in with or better than what you came in with, and that your structures are intact. And that's the big benefit of having an audiologist remove your wax. We are accessible, so you can usually get an appointment pretty quickly. And if you need a higher level of care, like at an ear, nose, and throat doctor's office, we're gonna refer you on. Some of the contraindications that we won't be able to take out wax out of your ears is if you already have a perforation in your eardrum, there's drainage of some sort, some kind of liquid draining out, you've had trauma to your ears, or if you're diabetic. Interesting thing with diabetes is that it changes the pH in the ear canal, which may make people susceptible to having otitis externa, which is an infection of the outer ear after wax is removed. And sometimes we just think it's best for you to see an ear, nose, and throat doctor. If you see an ENT, they will typically refer you to an audiologist after they take out wax. And so we're going to go ahead and test your ears afterwards. And that's just a higher level of care. So that's how we can help musicians with that. One of the other things I wanted to touch on was tinnitus. Tinnitus, hyperacusis, and diplacusis. Tinnitus is the perception of sound without external auditory stimulus. Many people describe it as they hear the sound in their head, but they know it's not physically coming from something on the outside. We'll ask you about if your tinnitus that you hear is pulsatile, which means that it has like a beat to it, or whoosh, whoosh, kind of, I'm just telling you the sound that people may hear, like a whooshing sound, but it definitely has a rhythm to it. If you have pulsatile tinnitus, we will refer you back to your primary care physician or an ear, nose, and throat physician. And it's usually a circulatory issue where they'll give you an ultrasound of your carotid in your neck. Mm-hmm. If you have non-pulsatile tinnitus, which is ringing or buzzing sounds in your ear, it may come and go, it may be constant, it may be one-sided or in both ears. Sometimes patients say that it sounds like it's just coming from their head. That will go ahead and give you an audiologic evaluation. We'll look to see if there's any excessive wax that could be causing the tinnitus. We'll look to see if you have any noise-induced hearing loss. We'll also, what we call tinnitus matching or pitch match, we'll try to match the sound that you're hearing. We'll do some handicap inventories, and this allows us to know how much stress the patient is having or psychological distress the patient is having because of tinnitus. If someone comes up to you and reports, like a student of yours or a colleague, and they report that they're having tinnitus, try not to dismiss it. Some people are more exacerbated by the tinnitus. It's disturbing their sleep. It could be disturbing activities where they're not able to hear the music that they're playing because the tinnitus is so loud. If that is the case, please see an audiologist. We can measure some of these things and work as a group with other professionals to get patients the help that they need and to reduce the tinnitus that they're experiencing. So we have different inventories and questionnaires that allow us to find out how disturbing the tinnitus is. Family history of tinnitus we'll ask you about, and definitely we'll ask you about your medications. Are you on an aspirin regimen? Aspirin is ototoxic, especially in high doses, it can cause tinnitus. We don't recommend that patients stop any medication. Obviously, they're on aspirin for a reason. So we usually go ahead and test you to see if you're experiencing some hearing loss, and we'll probably do serial tests. And we may work with your primary care physician if we think that the medication is getting in the way of your hearing or your tinnitus. We may look to see if there's a different medication that you can take. We'll take a look at your caffeine intake. Methotrexate is another medication. Usually is to treat rheumatoid arthritis. It can also treat leukemia and ectopic pregnancy, quinine, and diuretics too as well. There are more, but these are just some of the common ones that I come across. There's tinnitus retraining therapy. So if you do score high on the tinnitus handicap inventory, we may recommend that you get tinnitus retraining therapy or cognitive behavioral therapy for tinnitus. And then we'll also counsel patients who may not score as high. We'll recommend that they avoid excessive quiet. Excessive quiet is just as bad as excessive noise. So we don't want you to be in total silence. The tinnitus tends to rear its ugly head in excessive quiet as well. We'll ask you to wear hearing protection when it's appropriate, or amplification when it's appropriate. So those are some of the ways we can help with tinnitus, hyperacusis, and diplacusis. And there are some audiologists who specialize in tinnitus. So just wanted to let you know that. Finally, I want to touch on sudden hearing loss. Just to educate you, if this happens to you or to a colleague or to a student, it's actually an emergency situation, and we really want you to get to see an audiologist right away. The prevalence is 1 out of every 5,000 people will experience it. They wake up with not able to hear in one ear. They may have buzzing or dizziness. It may occur 3 weeks after a cold or flu, or they may hear a pop sound and all of a sudden they've suddenly lost their hearing. The reason you would want to see an audiologist as soon as possible is that we can go ahead and measure how bad the hearing loss is, what type it is, if it's sudden neural hearing loss, the sooner we get you to an ear, nose, and throat physician to get treatment, the better it is. Sometimes patients will put off getting help because they think it's something more benign, like wax in their ears or sinus infection or allergies, and it's not. So if something suddenly happens to your hearing loss, please find an audiologist right away. And again, there's findanaudiologist.org. These are my references, and thank you for having me. Really appreciate it.
Dana, thanks so much. Really appreciate all of that great information. And if people have questions, I would ask you to put them in the Q&A. Actually, we may have one already. Yes, we have a question here. How does excessive quiet worsen tinnitus?
Oh, yeah, that's a good question. Excessive quiet will make the tinnitus, so it makes your nerve hypersensitive to sound. So I do have patients putting earplugs in their ears, thinking that the tinnitus will go away because they are putting themselves in excessive quiet. You'll actually become hypersensitive to regular sounds. Going outside will seem overwhelming to you. And that ear and the nerve actually wants to hear. And so when we're deprived of sound, our nerve actually gets more sensitive to sound. And so that activity can make the tinnitus worse.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, interesting. I was curious, Dana, about the use of headphones. And I like many of our attendees, I downloaded the app. And I noticed, I was reading 43 decibels, but I'm using a headphone for this. So I took out my headphone and I put it up to my phone like this, and it read like 70 decibels. So, you know, the sound coming out of that. So obviously I'm getting way more sound into my ear, but how is there a way to measure that to know what our, because a lot of us use headphones on a regular ear, you know, an earbud or whatever. Is there a way to measure that?
It's actually pretty hard to measure that as a layperson. I think that was a great idea for you to put your headphone up into the microphone for you to get some idea of what it is like. Really, audiologists, what we would do for in-ear monitors, we'll actually put a microphone in your ear, call a probe mic, and we'll go ahead and measure. So if you see an audiologist, we can do that to see how loud it is. But unfortunately, to my knowledge, there's not something out on the market that can show you how loud your earphone is outputting. I know at Sensaphonics, if you have any ear monitors, they can tell you how loud the output is coming, but that would be by each manufacturer. And I think probably because there's high liability there.
Yeah.
If they're outputting something, they're not really, excited about putting that information out there. So.
Yeah, they're not excited about it, but it seems like they ought to, right?
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, interesting. Let's see, I think there's a question in the chat. Which brand of earplugs do you recommend for professional musicians?
My question back would be, what are you using it for?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure. So, yeah.
I don't know if that, it does. Can I ask a question?
Yeah, maybe the person who asked
maybe
that question.
Maybe they'll respond.
Yeah. So what's the use of it? Yeah.
While
this person is doing this, here's another one, connected to that. What brands of electronic hearing protection work best for orchestral musicians without compromising sound quality? I've had limited success with the company sound gear, which is very expensive.
So if you do, I would say a custom earplug. So you don't want to look like you don't want to be where you are. You don't want anything sticking out, looking like you're trying to avoid being with your colleagues. So if you can get something that's custom and flat to the head, they usually come in these filters for 9, 15, and 25 by Etymotic Research out of Australia. And the 9s are typically enough to decrease the sound by about 9 decibels, just kind of shave off the intensity of the sounds. You can get it in clear, so it looks like your skin color or your ear. And that way it doesn't look like you don't want to be there. Of course you want to you love the music, you want to be there. And I think just taking it down 9 decibels would be really great, so that you don't feel over attenuated. You still have to hear the room. You want to hear the timbre of other instruments. You know, you don't want to be excluded from that situation. So I would suggest custom with maybe 9.
That's great. The earlier question, questioner has clarified, orchestra and loud dance competitions. So brand of earplugs for those.
Okay, so headphones. Oh, earplugs. Sorry, earplugs yeah. For dance competitions and orchestral music. Yeah. So for dancing, I'm sure there's going to be hard floors around you. So that makes a difference. The acoustics in the room, it can be more echoey, depending on what kind of music they're dancing to. I would also probably recommend the 9s to take off some of the edge off of it. And that will allow you to last longer without feeling like you're excluded from the situation. I do have some plugs that you can get off of Amazon. They're called Etymotic Research plugs. If you have petite ears, I'm more petite in my ear canals. Some women and children are. You may get a smaller plug versus what's a little bit bigger. Can I just pop over to the room and grab them real quick?
Yeah, sure. She's going to go do that. Yeah, folks, if you've got any more questions, we'll have to wrap up pretty soon. But obviously, this is really, really interesting. All of us have, I've heard that every musician has an issue.
There she is. Excuse my scraps. Okay, so these are the small ones. I would probably wear these. They are called Baby Blues. And what's nice about it is that they have this little box, which is key to having your plugs with you. You put it on your keychain. And then no matter where you go, you typically have your plugs. I've been to so many venues and my plugs are in the car and I couldn't go back and get them. These are the regular size here too as well. Again, they kind of stick out. So sometimes they're not great if you are a professional musician. You don't want to look like you don't want to be somewhere. So I'm getting a custom one that's a little more flatter, but these say 20, but they're not 20. They're about 12 in real life of reduction.
Mm-hmm. Terrific. Thanks. Well, Dina, unfortunately, I think we're going to have to wrap this up. I think I'm sure there are lots of other questions, but you had an email address, right?
Sure. Let me share that screen one more time.
That'd be great. Yeah. So folks can. And Dina has graciously offered if people want to contact her about any of these. And obviously, real serious professional questions, you might have to get an appointment with her, but she'd be glad to be in contact with you. So there's her information. Great. Thanks so much, Dina. And to our attendees, I hope you've enjoyed this College Music Society webinar and you found it professional and informative. In the next days, webinar attendees should receive email confirmation of your attendance. Please feel free to use the comment option in that email to provide feedback about this series and our format. I hope you'll return for future webinars from the College Music Society, including our next Musicians Health session, which will be broadcast on Friday, April 22nd, with physiotherapist Isabel Artigas, entitled Risk Factors, Signs of Injury, and Prevention in the Performing Arts, as well as our next cultural inclusion workshop, which is scheduled for Sunday, May 22nd. Now, on behalf of all of us at the College Music Society, I want to thank Dr. Dina Glasenhardt for her presentation and all of our listeners for attending. Please accept our best wishes for today and the upcoming weeks. I'll see you back here in April.